Hello, I would like to thank the meeting organizers for facilitating this online format today, and in particular, to thank them for inviting me to give a plenary at this year's Goldschmidt Conference. I'm honored to have this opportunity to address the international geochemical community from this platform. Now, the topic that I chose for my talk today is one that I thought might appeal to this audience, but I confess that I was actually staging a little bit of a sneak attack, because the title of my talk gives the appearance that focusing on the importance of geochemistry helps to open our eyes to the dynamics of past, present, and future sea level rise. And while the geochronology aspect is critical to reconstructing past sea level, in fact, my intention was to highlight the importance of the extremely interdisciplinary nature of the work that my research group has been carrying out, and to emphasize the importance of a more holistic approach to sea level reconstruction, rather than being overly reliant on just the geochemical data when interpreting the past. So in a nutshell, this talk highlights the importance of diverse perspectives and of complementary methodological approaches to help tease apart the history of the dynamics of sea level rise and ice sheet retreat that is so important in helping us to understand how these processes will reshape the densely populated coastlines around the world in the years to come. So if that is what you've come to hear, then you're in the right place. But given everything that is going on in the world right now, I confess that I've been having a hard time trying to carry on with science as usual. While I will spend some time talking about my research on sea level rise, I am going to take a moment first to hijack my own presentation, if you will, to talk to you about why Black Lives Matter. Now, I recognize that you have the privilege of stopping this video right now and not watching it if you don't want to hear me talk about why Black Lives Matter. You may be able to choose when you want to listen to or pay attention to diversity, equity, and inclusion in academia, but not everyone can. I applaud the Geochemical Society for holding an online forum recently and for providing online sessions and panels at this year's virtual Goldschmidt Conference. But this is no longer a sideshow, and it fully deserves a spotlight in the first plenary of the week. Because learning about and discussing this issue is not just for those who are already marginalized, and it's not just for those who choose to go to the sessions on diversity, equity, and inclusion. This is an issue that the entire community needs to address, because geoscience has a whiteness problem. I do not pretend to be an expert on such matters, but I acknowledge my privilege as a white woman and have chosen this moment to listen, to learn, and to lift up the voices of others. So why do I bring this up during a plenary talk? Because when we build up people, we build up science. You cannot separate the two. For those of you who are not familiar with the lay of the land here, I'd like to introduce you to some rather breathtaking statistics. Now, these are statistics from the United States, which is what I am most familiar with, but this is an issue that pertains to the broader international community as well. Shown here on this graph is the percentage of master's degrees awarded to underrepresented minorities. This graph looks has a similar pattern, if you will, for bachelor's, master's, and PhD degrees in that earth sciences is dead last in comparison to all of the other STEM disciplines that are shown here. So when I say that this is an issue for our discipline, I think this graph really drives that point home. If you have not read this article by Kuheli Dutt, you should. It is a short two-pager and it is worth every moment of your time. One of the things that she discusses is the need for a cultural change within our discipline. And while this cultural shift starts at an individual level, it does not end there. And one of the points that she makes is to draw this distinction between being passively non-racist to actively anti-racist. And I confess that I have all too often in the past found myself in the role of being passively non-racist. And that is something that I need to work on. All of us need to work on it. And there are many ways that we can do this. Today, I would like to put forward a suggestion to challenge those of you who are listening, who are in supervisory roles, such as a chair, director, or dean of your department, school, or division, to add a new item to your annual review process that reads something like this: to Describe the steps that you have taken to improve the diversity and inclusion of your research group, department, and/or the college, university that you are in. This is not intended to be a mandate to require people to engage in such activity or be assessed on it, but it does force a self-reflection at least once a year for us to take stock and consider whether we have just been passive bystanders or whether we are engaging in anti-racist actions to bring about change, because we all must be part of this solution. And being passive is saying that you are okay with the status quo and is no longer enough. It never was, in fact. And when early career researchers asked me for advice in the past on how to be successful in this discipline, I've now boiled it down to really a one-word answer: resilience. I have persevered through a patriarchal academic culture that selects for only the most resilient amongst us. Not the best and the brightest necessarily, or the most innovative and creative, but the most resilient. And while I have experienced plenty of sexism, one of the things I never had to deal with was racism on top of that. So when I look around me now in my profession, I do see more women, but I see an overwhelmingly white demographic. There is no question in my mind that my career has benefited from white privilege. But as long as we continue supporting the status quo, and by focusing only on science in our plenary talks, we will continue to select for the most privileged and the most resilient. And that fundamentally needs to change. So I will leave you with this meme that I found online that I have redesigned here to treat racism like COVID-19, which you can read for yourself here. But I'd particularly like to emphasize the last one, that we should all be willing to change your life to end it. So having said all that, I'm going to take a deep breath and let that simmer on the back burner for you a while I seamlessly transition to talking about what you probably came to this talk for, which is some combination of geochemistry and sea level change. To hear more about my work in science communication and how social justice is intertwined with sea level rise, I would encourage you to listen to my other talk that is on the schedule for tomorrow and join us for a live panel session. Now, I'm not going to have time to get to all the awesome science that I wanted to share with you today in the remaining time that I have. So I'm going to give you a high-level overview, if you will, starting by acknowledging the team of students and postdocs and collaborators that I have been working with. And this is not an exhaustive list, but I've tried to capture the names of the people who have been closely involved in the work that I am summarizing here today. I'd like to give a special shout out for my colleague Jody Webster, who has been really integral to a lot of this work at some of the different field sites that I will be showing you. And he's shown here on the right. Okay, so the basic technique that I use to reconstruct sea level through time is looking at fossil corals that need to grow near the sea surface to survive. And I date them using uranium-thorium or U-series dating to give us a precise and accurate time at which those corals grew, and then we can survey the position of the coral in the field to get the elevation. And fundamentally, those are the only two pieces of information you need to reconstruct sea level through time. You need an age for the x-axis, and you need an elevation for the y-axis. When I'm going to be talking to you a little bit about a time period known as the last interglacial, about 125,000 years ago. That's the warm period before the last ice age, and it's often used as an analog when we talk about future sea level change. And when we first started looking at this time period and trying to date it using uranium and thorium isotopes, with the advent of mass spectrometry, we were able to do so with much more precision and accuracy. And so the question being asked was to see if the timing of the sea level high stands agreed with that was predicted by Milankovitch theory. And in fact, it does. And that's what's shown here in this paper by Larry Edwards, with time on the x-axis, with older ages over here to the left, time proceeding this way to the right, looking at an insolation curve here, showing how much of the sun's energy coming in 65 degrees north, and the timing of the corals from the last interglacial that he dated fell between these two lines, agreeing with the timing of this insolation curve. But now the questions that we are starting to ask about this time period and thinking of it as an analog for the future are much more complex and refined. So some of those questions are, what is the duration of the sea level high stand? How high did sea level get? How quickly did sea level rise? So that we can better understand how quickly the polar ice sheets can retreat as we go into the future. And were there suborbital oscillations in sea level that many people have seen evidence for, which has been a little bit contentious in the past? Now, there are several different challenges to using this technique overall in trying to reconstruct sea level, one of which is that corals are very susceptible to alteration because of their aragonite mineralogy. And that can lead to open system behavior of the uranium and thorium isotopes that we are using to date them. So that is one challenge. And many of the people who used to date corals have now migrated over into focusing on stalagmites, which are much less susceptible to alteration because corals are messy and they are difficult. Another challenge is understanding the evolution of seawater chemistry through time, particularly with respect to uranium isotopes, which affects our interpretation of the ages, as I will talk about a bit more in a moment. And while the precision of the U-series measurements has been increasing over time, it has started to outstrip the accuracy of the standards that we are using in different laboratories around the world. And this becomes a problem because if you see an offset in ages and values for that you have measured, you have to start to ask, is that just because of an interlaboratory difference or is it something real? And so this is something that the community has been grappling with. There are also some other effects that affect not the age, but the elevation component that I mentioned before. One of those are the effects of geophysical processes, such as glacial isostatic adjustment and dynamic topography, both of which can bias or have changed the elevation of the corals that we sampled for time. And in addition to that, one of the largest uncertainties in this type of reconstruction is understanding the precise water depth at which those corals grew. We know that sea level must have been at least as high as the coral, but sometimes it's hard to say exactly how much higher seawater was. So if we look at some of the publications from the last interglacial that have tried to reconstruct the evolution of sea level through the high stand, I put together this cartoon a few years ago that shows a compilation of many different papers and studies. All of these are from coral reefs except for one of them, and that's the Red Sea record here. Now, time is progressing in the other direction on this diagram from right to left. But the main point I want to make here is that you can get all types of different results looking at these different papers. You see one peak, two peak, three peaks, four. It sounds like the beginning of a nursery rhyme a little bit. And you can even see that working at the same site that different authors have interpreted different number of peaks in sea level during the last interglacial. So when you look at the literature, it really looks like a bit of a mess. And one of the challenges, or one of my interpretations here, is that one of the problems over time is that we have become overly reliant upon the geochemical data. And once we get an age for the corals and we have the elevation, that we connect the dots and draw a curve, not thinking carefully enough about the context of those corals within the reef. Do we need to be drawing a line that goes down to connect to that coral, or was that coral just living in deeper water? And so understanding the field context of these samples is critical to the interpretation of sea level through time, because clearly one thing must have happened in terms of global sea level here that explains the evidence that people saw at all these different sites. So while before I said that there are only two things you need, in fact, I would argue that you need much more than this. Before I get to that, I do want to make a few points related to the chronology, because I know that this is a geochemical crowd, to talk about some advances that we have made with this respect. So one of the things that I have been focusing on, in particular looking at these past sea level records, is to the development and curation of databases of U-series data for the fossil corals, as well as developing open access software for U-series cyber infrastructure, That has been in collaboration with Jim Bowering, Noah McLean, and Ken Rubin. You can go to our website, useries.rocks, to learn more and to download the software. There are some links to do that there. We would love to get more community feedback from this software that we have developed. So this has helped us to be able to compare all of the legacy data that is out there a little bit better. And we have also put out some data reporting standards so that we can compile and compare these data better in the future as we move forward. At the same time, we've also made some steps in understanding the evolution of seawater uranium isotopes through time. And that is shown here in this graph from a paper from one of my PhD students, Peter Chucharevan, where we have plotted the delta 234, which is the ratio of uranium-234 to 238 in the seawater over time. And it was some of these exercises up here of data compilation and normalizing things between different labs that has allowed us to do this reconstruction now. And this shows a significant change in seawater composition from the last glacial maximum to the present. It is harder if we go all the way back to the last interglacial that was 125,000 years ago, somewhere over here, because a lot of those corals are altered and it's difficult to tell which part of the signal is primary when we get back that far. This parameter is important because we use this to screen out altered corals. Altered corals have often have elevated delta 234 values. And so understanding how seawater composition evolved does make a difference in terms of what ages we interpret from the data that we have measured. Okay, so if we go back to this diagram again and start thinking about some of the other components that I mentioned, like the geophysical considerations of glacial isostatic adjustment and dynamic topography. So I've been working very closely with some geophysicists to try to better understand this link so that we can do a better job in reconstructing global sea level from what are really local records of relative sea level change. But in addition to that, we're also spending a lot more time on the techniques that used to really form the basis of sea level reconstructions before we had these really precise chronologies. And that is the sedimentological context of them. So we spend a lot of time looking at the sedimentology and stratigraphy of the reefs in the field, looking at the coral reef assemblages as a whole, not just the coral that we've sampled, to better constrain the paleo water depth of the corals that we are looking at. So again, trying to reduce that vertical uncertainty in our reconstructions, and also looking at the diagenesis and the taphonomy in the corals, which in itself can tell us a lot about sea level change through time. So by looking at all of these different components together, we can create a more robust interpretation of sea level through time. So I'm going to walk you through just a couple quick examples of that. I'm going to have to gloss over a lot of the details here in the interest of time, but I'm going to take you on a little trip to the Seychelles and to Western Australia. Both of these are far field sites, so far away from the former margins of ice sheets, so that we have minimal effects in terms of glacial isostatic adjustment. And as you can see, looking at the pictures here, the Seychelles is, of course, a very beautiful place to work, but we did have a lot of reasons that were scientifically motivated for going there. One that I mentioned is that it is a far field site. Another is that there are reports of some very high corals from the last interglacial that we wanted to look at. And when we got there, we found that most of the last interglacial reef actually has been weathered away. And you can see there's very intense chemical weathering in the Seychelles. You can see that by the evidence of the fluting and the rills in the granite substrate that these are growing on. So the only parts of the reef that are left are bits of the reef that are protected by these granite overhangs. And when we go out snorkeling in the reef, we can find this type of morphology that you see here, where the corals are actually attaching on the side of these granite walls. They tend to do that above the reef flat between 0 and 2 meters of water. And that's consistent with the coral assemblages that we see in there. So somewhat fortuitously, even though most of the reef has washed away, the part that has been preserved is that that was closest to the shore and sitting above the reef flat, the shallowest part of the reef, which gives us more precision in terms of interpreting where sea level was through time. These are some more pictures of what these outcrops look like. In some cases, this was coral rubble that had been cemented together, but in many cases, we were able to find in-situ reef framework that we focused on, and we looked at sites from three different islands that are shown up here on the map. And here is a picture of Karen Viberberg, who's a PhD student of mine who led this work here in the Seychelles. She looks a little glum right now, but we actually got a lot of great data out of this outcrop. And it's hard to see what's going on in this picture for you, so I'm going to help you out and put some interpretation over the top of it. So what we see in this outcrop was typical of what we saw at these outcrops in the Seychelles, where we had in-situ reef framework. We see evidence for episodic reef growth, that is, different generations of reef growth that have been stacked one on top of each other. And it appears that these reefs died, and then another one grew on top, and another one on top of that. In this particular outcrop, in the transitions between those reef units, we see a millepora, which is a hydrozoan coral that has encrusted and grown laterally. It's draped itself over the entire outcrop. It's quite common for millepora to colonize the surfaces of dead corals. And so our interpretation is that this reef grew, it died, the millepora came in, another reef grew, it died. In some cases, we don't see millepora in the transitions, we just see coral rubble, or we see very sharp discontinuity. But in each case, it appears that we have this episodic reef growth. And the final reef unit is the least extensive vertically, and we often see these encrusting corals that show evidence of growing in very limited accommodation space. We have looked in detail at the assemblages, which are, again, agree with our interpretation from the morphology of the outcrop itself, that we are in less than 2 meters of water. And in addition to that, we see evidence in this second transition layer up here between the middle reef unit and the top for an ephemeral sea level fall. In the Seychelles, we see in some cases a freshwater cement that has been overlain by a marine cement in the pore spaces in these corals in the reef unit. So that's evidence of subaerial exposure followed by marine inundation again. We also see some karstification of the top of this middle reef unit again, which is more evidence that the sea level fell and this top part of the reef was exposed. So we have some U-series chronology to go along with these outcrops now. I'm glossing over the details on the preservation of the corals in the interest of time, but I can tell you that these are some of the best preserved corals I've seen from the last interglacial from any site around the world. So we were fortuitous in that sense as well. So here, time is proceeding from right to left on this diagram, and this is elevation locally in the Seychelles on the y-axis. The different colors of these data points represent different outcrops. So these are the different sites that are listed over here in the legend. And you can see in this trend of increasing sea level that's outlined by these data points, that the data from different sites overlaps with one another. And this tight overlap really tells us that they are growing at the same paleo water depth in less than 2 meters of water. If they were growing much deeper, some of those points would plot below. These blue points here were collected from different type of outcrop that I did not show you a picture of. There were some places where there were little protected caves that we walked into and corals growing in there. That appears to be a slightly deeper environment, not much, mind you, still only a meter or two, but a little bit deeper than those ones that were attached to the side walls and that were seaward facing. This data point over here was a coral that was collected by someone else and we can't verify its stratigraphic context. This is a lesson in don't date something that you haven't collected because then you don't know how to interpret it. But I put it there because we dated it. Okay, so if we focus on this rising trend that these data points outline, if we were to connect the dots and draw a line, we would have gradually rising sea level at a rate that's shown here in the upper right-hand corner, about 0.3 meters per thousand years. That's about an order of magnitude lower than the rate of sea level rise that we are experiencing today. But this masks the true rates of change of sea level through this whole time interval that we know from looking at the sedimentary evidence, because we do have evidence that between reef B and C here, that sea level fell and then rose again. So those would have been faster rates, because we don't know how far it fell. We cannot put a magnitude on that fall or ascribe a particular rate to it, other than to say it must have been much faster. Now, the transition here between reef A and reef B was captured in all of the outcrops that we dated. The millipora themselves were altered, so we had to date corals on either side to bound the timing of these transitions between the reef units. So in this case, this one is pretty well dated at about 126,000 years ago. This transition here is dated as about 124,000 years ago. So what we have here is episodic reef growth separated by an ephemeral sea level fall here. In terms of the sedimentology, this transition looks very similar. We did not see in some of the thin sections we had that stratigraphy in the freshwater and marine cements. So we can't say for sure that that was caused by a sea level fall. It could have been something else that caused the reef to die, but it certainly manifests very similar to this transition layer that we see in some of the other outcrops. Okay. Overall, though, this picture tells us that we have sea level rising from about 129,000 years ago and peaking at about 122,000 to 123,000 years ago. After that, sea level started to fall. We don't have that record because it would have been migrating offshore, and that part of the reef is gone. So we only have this record of essentially the sea level rise as the reefs were accreting upwards. Okay, so very quickly, I'm going to take you over to Western Australia to look at some of the sites over there and see how that compares. We went to the site of Red Bluff because it has been tectonically uplifted. This white arrow is a doubly plunging anticline that runs right through Red Bluff and has exposed the entire last interglacial reef so that we can see it in three dimensions and look at the evolution of the reef through time. So we have described several sites along this terrace, going from site one here over to site seven over here. So more seaward is site seven as we move in that direction. I'm going to show you what a few of these sites look like and compare that to the Seychelles. We have, again, three vertically stacked reef units, so more evidence for episodic reef growth, transition layers in between. In this case, at site one, which was the most landward of the sites, those transition layers are filled with red material from the Red Bluff and bedrock cobbles. So this is all terrestrial material that's been derived from the bluff and has been deposited on top of the reef. It would have been washed away if we were still in the marine environment here, but our interpretation is that sea level has fallen. This represents subaerial exposure of all this terrestrial material coming in before it rose again, and you have another reef unit that grew on top. This is consistent with what we see at sites two and three and so forth as we move more seaward. In this case, though, the transition layer does look a little bit different. At site two, which again is moving closer towards the ocean, we have this terrestrial material and the bedrock cobbles again, and there's a very sharp discontinuity. And on top of that, we have these white marine sands coming in. So this is a brief regression where we get subaerial exposure, deposition of the terrestrial material, and then a transgression where we have the marine sands coming in on top and then a reef growing above as it gets the accommodation space with sea level rise. This transition layer looks exactly the same as you move down along the cliff face to the next site. Again, terrestrial material overlain by marine sands within this transition layer, showing us evidence for sea level fall and rise. And we see evidence for sea level fall and rise at both of these transition layers, indicating at least two ephemeral sea level falls. We've also been to at least six other sites distributed around the globe in the past 6 or 7 years. And I can tell you that despite the fact that there should be local differences in the pattern of relative sea level at each of these sites, there is a commonality that is emerging from the stratigraphy that we're seeing at these last interglacial fossil reefs. That is that we have this discontinuous or episodic reef growth that represents pulsed sea level rise, separated by brief ephemeral sea level falls. At some of the far field sites, it also shows sea level at least several meters above present. Very early within the sea level high stand, you would have seen that on the graph from the Seychelles, where it was already close to 6 meters, indicating that we already had significant meltwater contributions very early on. But overall, sea level was rising, creating accommodation space for these reefs to grow, but we had these episodes of sea level fall that intervened. Combined with that, there's also evidence, very different type of evidence, not from fossil reefs, but in the North Atlantic and the Red Sea, if we combine some of the geochemical records from forams coming from those places, Elko Rolling recently published a paper last year where they concluded that based on this information, looking at seawater salinity and temperatures and the sea level record, that they were able to tease apart contributions from freshwater in the North Atlantic versus those coming from the Southern Hemisphere during the last interglacial. They concluded that there were out-of-phase contributions from the Southern Hemisphere and the Northern Hemisphere, from the Antarctic ice sheet and the Greenland ice sheet. This is consistent with our hypothesis of what is driving this pattern that we're seeing in the reefs, that you have one ice sheet that's melting while the other one is growing, and so that they are out of phase with each other. And if one is melting faster, that creates accommodation space for the reefs to grow. And then if you have one growing faster than the other is melting, you get an ephemeral sea level fall. And that is what is the combination of those two is leading to this signal that we are recording in the far field. So when we think about ice sheet contributions during the last interglacial, several years ago, we came up with this sea level budget that estimated where meltwater was coming from during peak sea level during the last interglacial. And we divided it between the Antarctic ice sheet and the Greenland ice sheet, as well as adding all the mountain glaciers and some thermal expansion to that. But if the ice sheets were contributing out of phase, then this way of putting together a sea level budget would be incorrect. Shown here are some models of the Antarctic ice sheet in blue and the Greenland ice sheet in orange and green. The Greenland ice sheet models show maximum meltwater contributions occurring later in the interglacial, closer to that peak that we had near 122 or 123,000 years ago. If you add the curves from Greenland and Antarctica, you end up with about 6 to 9 meters of sea level rise, which is about what we estimate we see in the far field. In addition, these models are showing an early contribution from Antarctica and a later contribution from Greenland, which overall also agrees with the data from the Rolling paper that I mentioned before. It also agrees with the pattern of temperatures in the two hemispheres, is that it was warmer earlier in the Southern Hemisphere in the early part of the interglacial, and it was warmer later in the Northern Hemisphere in the later part. So this is consistent with this idea that we may have had out-of-phase ice sheet contributions leading to this pattern of episodic reef growth in the far field. But had we just dated the corals and connected the dots, we would not have seen this picture. This is still a hypothesis that we are putting forward for the community to test. It's a really interesting idea, but it also suggests that the individual ice sheets may be changing more rapidly, and those rates of change may be masked by this overall seemingly slow rate of sea level rise that we saw in the far field. So overall today, this presentation has highlighted the importance of combining diverse perspectives and looking at these problems using many different approaches to them, whether or not we are thinking about corals in the science or thinking about the people doing the science. The importance of diverse perspectives holds true. Thank you very much for your attention.